In my last year's video about induction motors, I really didn't go into any details about starting circuits and reversing of induction motors, so I'll cover that now. The rotor of an induction motor is essentially a permeable iron core with a short circuit winding that's cast in place, and that causes it to resist changes in magnetic field, which causes it to follow any sort of spinning magnetic field. For three-phase motors, the sense of rotation is inherent in the three phases coming into the motor, but for a single-phase motor, like this split-phase induction motor, a sense of rotation has to be created with a bit of trickery using a capacitor. This is the schematic for the induction motor where we have two windings that are at a right angle, and one of these windings is connected directly to AC, whereas the other one is in series with a capacitor. On this induction motor, one of the windings is these two coils, and the other winding is these two coils. So this winding goes this way for magnetic field, the other one this way. And the interaction of the inductance of the coils here and the capacitor causes one of the windings to be shifted 90 degrees. So as this one goes up and down and this one goes side to side, they're out of phase 90 degrees, so we get a sense of rotation. Reversing this type of motor is trivially easy. All I have to do is move the AC from directly to this coil to directly to this coil, and then through the capacitor, the other winding is delayed. So essentially, all I have to do is move the power connection from here to here. So here's the capacitor, and all I have to do is move this clip to the other side of the capacitor to reverse it. And this becomes much easier to see if I slow down the motor a lot by reducing the voltage. So you can see now it goes counterclockwise, and now I move this clip, and now it's clockwise. Now if we look inside this 3/4 horsepower motor, you can see the windings are not as easy to discern. Essentially, the winding is split over many slots in the stator here, and that makes the transition from pole to pole a lot smoother, which makes for a quieter, more efficient motor. Looking closely at the windings, you can see there's a winding that goes here, and then there's another one that goes here, and that's made out of thicker wire, and that's the main winding. And then if we have another winding that's kind of to the inside of that, that's made out of thinner wire that goes here and here. So now if I put a compass in here and I put DC through the main winding, you can see we have a horizontal magnetic field. And if I move that clip to activate the starter winding, you can see we have a vertical magnetic field. So those windings are 90 degrees out of phase with each other. One end of the starter winding is connected to this red wire, and that goes to this capacitor, and then the other side of this capacitor goes through this black wire onto here, and that's the starter switch, and that gets disconnected once the motor's up to speed. So the schematic for this motor is very similar to our split phase motor, with one winding directly on the AC and the other one in series with a capacitor on AC, except that this winding is much thinner and we turn off the winding once the motor's up to speed. The starter winding is automatically turned off with a centrifugal switch, and the way that works is these two metal clips get pulled out by centrifugal force once it spins at full speed, and that pulls back this plate here. When the motor is not at full speed, this plate rubs against this plastic tab here, and as long as that plastic tab is pushed, this starter contact is closed, and then once it's up to speed, the plate pulls away and it no longer rubs against here, so we don't get friction and wear. So if the starter winding helps to create a rotating magnetic field to spin up the motor, why disconnect it once the motor is actually up to speed? The whole phase shifting the starter winding with a capacitor is not as elegant as it would sound. The size of the capacitor very much depends on the expected load of the motor, and if we just connect it briefly temporarily at the start, it doesn't matter if it's a little bit inefficient or the wrong size, because we won't leave it engaged. Also, this capacitor is an electrolytic capacitor, and it's not designed to take a continuous AC load. If it got that kind of load, it would burn out, and to have a condenser for this size motor would be quite expensive. And because we turn off the winding once the motor's up to speed, we can also use a much thinner winding for the starter winding and save a bit of money that way, because copper is expensive. So just to turn off the starter winding makes an awful lot of sense. But once we turn off the starter winding, the magnetic field just goes back and forth, so why does the motor keep on spinning? You can compare that to moving the screwdriver back and forth with this pendulum. Just moving it side to side doesn't get the pendulum rotating, but if I rotate it, now it goes round and round, and now even if I just go side to side, I can keep that thing spinning for as long as I want to. Having said that, there are some motors called capacitor start capacitor run motors that have a beefier starter winding, and then they have a second capacitor that is in parallel with the starter switch and the starter capacitor that stays engaged, and that helps the motor run a little bit better. The motor in my table saw is that kind of motor, and it's got two bulges on there, one for a start capacitor, the other one for a run capacitor. So out of personal curiosity, I brought a wire out from this motor that goes to the starter winding, and I hooked that up to one channel of the oscilloscope, and the power in is on the other side. And here's my scope, and I've got the motor hooked up to a variac so I can run it at a reduced voltage. So let's slowly apply some voltage. And on the screen here, you can see two sine waves, one of which is shifted to the side a little bit. Each period of the sine wave represents one full circle turn, and the shift on here is about a quarter sine wave, so that's about 90 degrees, which is good. Now, so far this motor is not spinning, so let's give it a bit more voltage to actually get it running. And there it goes, and you hear the click. That's the starter switch disengaging, so now we still have a voltage on the main winding and the starter winding, even though we've actually disconnected the starter winding. And interestingly enough, the taller of these two sine waves is actually the starter winding, because if I disconnect this, you can see the taller waveform disappears. So it appears that the starter winding has more turns on it than the main winding, and the induced voltage is actually greater than the voltage going into the motor. To explain this a little bit better, I made a little diagram of the motor. The main winding is in green, and the starter winding is in red. And once that motor is running, we have this passively magnetized rotor, and it's in sync with the back and forth magnetic field from the main winding. But rather than demagnetize itself when it's at 90 degrees, it just simply magnetizes the stator from what's in here. So basically, that means we have, aside from a magnetic field this way, we have also one this way, together making a rotating magnetic field. And that means we have a magnetic field going through the windings of the starter, and that in turn induces a 90 degrees out of phase voltage in a starter winding, even though there's nothing hooked up to it. So how do we reverse this motor? I can't just move the AC power connection from here to here. That would reverse the motor, but that would make the starter winding the main winding, and they're very different, and that's not going to work very well. What we need to do instead is just to reverse one of these windings, so that essentially we make a mirror image of the magnetic field, and anything that was clockwise becomes counterclockwise. So if we can, for instance, just connect this to here, and connect this to here, and break these connections, we've swapped the polarity of this, and it will start in the opposite direction. Except if I look on the label for this motor, it says here, motor is non-reversible. It should be reversible, but why is it not? The problem is really one of cost cutting. There's only three wires coming out from the windings of this motor. Basically, what was done is inside the windings, the starter winding and the main winding share one wire that comes out. And so we only have one end of the starter winding and one end of the main winding. And unless I go in there and dig out this connection to bring this wire out separately, I can't swap the terminals on the starter winding, which means I can't reverse the motor. Of course, where there's a will, there's a way, so I could potentially dig out this connection in there and break it and bring out another wire. But the problem is there's no way to remove the stator from the case, so I'd literally have to cut a hole in the case to get at it. And I think that would just be more trouble than it's worth, so for all practical purposes, this motor can't be reversed because they saved one wire. But these motors here can be reversed, and reversing is always reversing the starter winding. So see here, for reversing, interchange red and green leads and terminal box in end casing. Basically, reversing the polarity of the starter winding. On this one, it says, for counterclockwise rotation, interchange red and black. Again, reversing the starter winding. And on this one, it says, to reverse rotation, interchange red and black wires. So reversing a single phase induction motor is always a function of reversing the polarity of the starting winding. The challenge is, on some motors, you just don't have access to the starter winding. And on other motors, you may have access to it, but first you have to figure out which one the starter winding actually is.